represent themselves. You come into an interview and you have to turn away. I'm female, I have to turn away because when they sit down, you know, I see the top of that. What a, that. Thank you. I think that's okay, whatever floats your boat. I'm just saying, they don't even know how to represent them. We've allowed anything to be okay. You know, I get calls, this is the, you know, I have an interview next week, and I just wonder, do I need to take all my piercing down? I mean, I can't tell you how to. I can tell you, though, that when you're a Fortune 500 company, you know, there are certain things that are acceptable and not acceptable and considered okay. Consider where you're going to work. I can't tell you what to do, but that's a decision you have to make. But we have allowed so many things. One of the things we look at and talk about and trying to get along, everybody just get along in this confusion of what's acceptable, not acceptable. We have generations trading. One of the things is to try to identify the generations, and then because you're in a certain category, typically you have different standards for work standards. You have different communication styles, and so we work with that, trying to get, again, all of us to kind of agree. So I thought it was interesting, and just by a show of hands, I'm sure we have the myriad in the house this morning. Those that were born between 1925 and 1942, raise your hand. You gotta do that slow, Cynthia. This is Elam. Okay. Was there somebody on the side? Okay, there we go. All right. Baby boomers, born between 1943 and 1960. Generation X, 1961 through 1981. Wow. That's interesting. And Generation Y, 1982 through 2002. And above, who's born after 2003? We got some babies. All right. This generation hasn't even named yet. So, you know, I point that out that says a lot about, you know, some of the issues that we have. And a lot of times, the parents, we're not communicating on the same level. We're not, things have changed and things are different. And as we mother and try to mother, we need to recognize that we can't do it in and of ourselves. As I said earlier, it's noble, it's honorable, but we can't do it of ourselves. We have got to, and I said women of God, my point was one some sentence, I have notes, but I just kind of go all over the page. But as women of God, we have got to do what God says do. The scripture says the train of a child in the way she go, Proverbs. Proverbs 11 and 30 also says, that when souls are wise. And so while being wise and doing what God says to do to train them in the way they should go, I thought it was interesting, Sister Jessica shared with me the other Sunday that when we were trying to do the Easter lesson. So the thing he brought away that Sunday was, Jesus, wash their feet and fail. I loved it. So we have to train them up in the way they should go. And Sister Kristen's son went back and told his grandma something about but Jesus, and she's trying to tell him to be good, but Jesus, you know, was talking, and so somewhere in a lesson he got that, and she was like, yeah, but you still, you know, need to be good and obey when somebody tells you not to talk. So it is awesome that there's an awesome responsibility that we have, and that we can't do this in and of ourselves. We do, with all the knowledge and all the information that we have to seek the Lord. And as Sister Hill said, there comes a point that you go, I don't know the answer. I don't know what to say. Or you've done everything that you know to do, and it appears that it's still not working because, you know, they are individual in and of themselves, and they have, all you can do is plant the seed, try to water it occasionally, and you know that it's growing because it's the word of God. It won't, when it goes out, it won't come back void. It is growing, whether they want to receive it then or not, because when you get in a tight place, everything that I knew that I thought I knew, and as hard as I didn't want to do what my mother told me to do, I thought, you know, that just really can't be the case all the time, my God. I came back to those things that my mother had taught me, or that the pastor's wife had taught us. One thing she used to always say is, when you get to that point that you think, I don't know what to say, I don't know what else to do with them, or you decide it's not worth it, know that someone's watching you, and live for that person. If you don't want to live for yourself, I mean, it's all right, as my daughter says, but live for that other person. Live for that other person. We have, again, an awesome responsibility. So mother someone, you know, tend to them. See about them. Call them every now and then. And give them a card. Sometimes you think you're out there by yourself, and you're not. Mentoring is mothering. Caring for that person. Be concerned about their soul. Not just how they're living. Be concerned for their soul, because if you just worry about how they're living, then you can throw a towel in. That's not the part that you just want to recognize. You know, maybe it's just in prayer. I used to think, Mom, why you go, even as I got older, I'd go visit, and she'd be like, you want to go pray with me in the morning? I'm off today. And I kept thinking, I'll be here when you get back. I would go, and she'd be there by herself and pray like Pastor do, like that place is full. And you know, today I think of that, and I appreciate having had that opportunity. It still taught me more in my 15 some years that when I attended those sessions with her, I didn't know that I would not have that opportunity again, but I appreciate that. And so that's some of mothering. As Pastor Donnell mentioned, that Sister Hill gave her words of wisdom, and pastors teaching us the end times and is concerned for our souls. And Pastor Donnell is committed in, you know, promoting and inspiring us evangelism. And mothering is one way that we compel and we draw others to Christ. Again, Proverbs 11:30 says that he who wins souls is wise. So as we go out among the wolves, the people today, Christ cautions us that we need to be cunning as a serpent and harmless as a dove in Matthew 10:16. You have to do each individual thing differently. People are watching for different things. People have had different experiences, and you can't just love up on everybody because you don't know what kind of past experience they've had. That might not have been a good experience for them. And we can't assume that someone knows what a loving mother is, someone that's genuinely concerned about them. I know the other Mother's Day a couple years ago, I didn't know Sister Ruby was an orphan. She's not here today, but she, you know, so you can't assume that everyone has had that kind of relationship. You have to be cunning, and you have to be wise, and use the word of God, have the word of God in you so that you can discern the needs of that person. and take the time with them. Sometimes we don't want to take time. We're so busy. And I have to even caution myself and remember that we're just so busy. But you have to